Welcome again. Today we would start with a very important topic under education, that's Yashpal committee. Now before we start with Yashpal committee, three important committees that you need to remember very well. First is Professor Yashpal committee that we would be talking about in detail. Then you have the new national education policy and it is headed by K. Kasturi Rangan. So that's recently coming up 2017 proposals. Now you have the National Knowledge Commission established by Sam Pitroda. And then the basics of the various education commissions, the first education commission, the Kothari commission, the Radhakrishnan commission and so on. So all those we would be discussing in a separate lecture. Coming on to Professor Yashpal committee, before that let's have a brief introduction about Professor Yashpal. Now why this committee is important, particularly for this year? So this committee is important because recently we had the demise of Professor Yashpal. Professor Yashpal did his PhD from Massachusetts Institute. He started his career from Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. He was known for popularizing science mainly among the kids and the students. He won the Kalinga Award, that is mainly for the popularization of science. Then he also won the Indira Gandhi Award for popularization of science. He also won Padma Bhushan and Padma Vibhushan Awards. He was the Chancellor of Jawaharlal Nehru University for 2007 to 2012. So those were some of his achievements that we have tried to bring out, but those are indeed very small in consideration to the contribution that he has given towards the field of science and education. Now his committee is known as the Committee to Advise on the Renovation and Rejuvenation of Higher Education. Now this itself has been a question in many of the set examinations and many of the teaching examinations where it has been asked. So what's the name of Professor Yashpal's committee? So the name of Professor Yashpal committee is the Committee to Advise on Renovation and Rejuvenation of Higher Education. Now we would be summarizing what were his ideas and the thoughts for the university. So he basically classified his whole draft into three ideas. First was what should be the idea of an ideal university, we can say. The next is what are the challenges that we are facing in the higher education. And thirdly, what are the roadmaps or what are the things that we need to look forward for the university approach. So he talked about the National Commission for Higher Education and Research as NCHER. So those were some of his suggestions that were laid down. Now first we will talk about the idea of the university, we'll move on to the challenges and then we'll discuss the roadmap that he propounded. So under the ideas of university, he said the university should be a place to germinate new ideas, new thoughts. It should bring in a kind of entire universe of knowledge within the student, develop a scholarly aptitude and bring out a kind of application of that scholarly aptitude. So right now what he considers as a university is one that imparts only theoretical knowledge which is far away from the practical realities. So he talked about bringing in a kind of impartial analysis to analyze and understand the level and ratings of the university and work on the idea of developing a practical aspects among the students for a university. This, he also said that university is based on the fundamental principle of transcendence. So those could be a kind of again very direct questions that could be asked. According to Professor Yashpal, university is based on which principle? So it's based on the fundamental principle of transcendence. And he said that the idea of university is to aspire thoughts, to aspire knowledge among the students and not only in one field but across all fields. Now what he feels is the basic challenges that a higher education system is facing. So according to him, the higher education system is coming up with numerous challenges. There is erosion of kind of autonomy that is taking place. There is loss of primacy of the university setup. There is distances between the knowledge and the attainment of the knowledge. So knowledge gap is, we can say, what is increasing. Universities are totally into isolation from the practical or the industrial world. So bringing more practicality, as we said, into universities was one of the major ideas that he recommended. Now he divided his proposals under different head. So the first challenge that he talked about was distance and disconnects. So what are the distances and the disconnects that a university system has? He talked about invisible walls. Now again, it's important where this phrase invisible walls was used. So invisible walls was used with Professor Yashpal's committee recommendation. And as we said, he said the approach is too much theoretical in nature. We don't understand the practical aspects of it. And moreover, the education is devoid of any experiences. So you are just learning for the sake of learning, for passing the exams, and that's it. There is no experience, no practicality that's being attained by the learning, and therefore learning becomes very superficial. So what he tries to believe here is there is a lack of understanding and lack of practicality that should be attained. The next under divides and disconnects he focused was the divide between the research body and the university. So he said that universities are the place where teaching and research should go hand in hand, and what really happens is they go into total isolation. So there should be a kind of bridging bar between the two, and research should be brought more closer to the teaching, and therefore teaching could be more successful in nature. We also try to reinforce this by bringing in separate policies that he tried to bring about for the enhancement of universities and developing the young minds. The next was a total isolation of IITs and IIMs, and that shows a real dismal condition of the top institutes of India. So what he believed was we must work for a overround or a all-round excellence of the students, and that is only possible when the institutes of higher education, typically the dominant or the renowned institutes in the country, work around with the proposals where they work in line with the mainstream, and they are not in total isolation or segregation. So we should work around the models that have been adopted by Massachusetts or Caltech. So those are the two universities that he mentioned. Now this could be again a very important question: what are the kind of universities he considered that we should take into account for developing our higher education base? So those are Massachusetts, MIT and Caltech. The next is erosion of democratic space. So the higher education is becoming more politicized. There is lack of democratic space that is being given for the uprising of the candidates within the university. So the geocultural diversities must be maintained, and to maintain this we need to have a kind of homogeneous environment that should be developed. The next is architecture of learning, the next important point. So as we talked about the various aspects, we have the architecture of learning, where we say students must face the issues to solve the real-time problem or the real-world problems, and that's what we talk about under the architects of learning. He works on revamping the curriculum and the syllabus. The syllabus that has been designed so far does not take into account the ability of an individual, and it has been defined only for the sake of coverage of these topics. So the new syllabus should focus more on abstract thinking, abstract knowledge and generation of creativity or think room, we can say, among the students. So that's the basic idea that we talk under curriculum issues and syllabus making. So irrespective of the discipline, all the students should be given a kind of occupational exposure. So once they have an occupational exposure, they really understand where they need to apply that knowledge to, and once they understand where the knowledge needs to be applied, they could gain more information and more knowledge. The next is learning across disciplines. So specializations, when you move towards specializations, you try to segregate yourself from the other disciplines. So what he said that was the higher education should be interdisciplinary in nature. That means, let's say if you're talking about social sciences, you should bring in context from sciences, humanities, mathematics and so on. So that's a kind of interdisciplinary approach that should be worked around with, along with the specialization, to develop a kind of inclusive characteristics for that education that you are trying to attain. Then teachers' education. Preparation of a good teacher is the sole responsibility of a good university. So he believes that teachers should be revamped, teachers' training programs should be enhanced, and state should take the responsibility for bringing in good teachers, and rather universities should take in responsibility to penetrate these good teachers to the college levels or the affiliated colleges. Now, if you look onto the Indian curriculum, most of the education system we have in the affiliated colleges, where you do not have good staff that is being seen. So what he believes is a kind of full-fledged orientation for the teacher should be done, or the teachers from the university should be sent in the extra time to the affiliated universities for enhancement of the curriculum and the students. The next is rehabilitating professional education in the university. So we are talking about providing in-depth knowledge in your field of specialization and the knowledge area. Also bringing in vocational education from outside within the purview of universities and colleges. So far, vocational education has been kept away from the existing college setup. So that should be integrated. He talked about that in India specifically, the undergraduate education is undermined. So we do not consider undergraduate education at par. So all bachelor's degrees are not considered or are not at the level they should be as compared to the other nations. So what the idea is, the university faculty should serve in the colleges, the affiliated colleges, as we said, and this undergraduate education system should be enhanced or improved. Even there should be cases where you have Nobel laureates, fields of specialists, scientists who should come up to teach students in the undergraduate programs as well. The performance criteria. Now, under performance criteria, we talk about infusing accountability in the organization. So we are trying to bring in or evolve performance criteria for the universities so that they could assess themselves and one university with the other. So all of them should work at par with others, and therefore performance criteria is again very, very important. So under that, we talk about three important parameters: academic excellence, we talk about the socio-cultural aims of higher education, and the institutional self-reforms. So those are considered under the performance criteria. The next is structure expansion and access. So under this, we talk about mainly bringing in private investment into the university setup. Once you have more investment or privatization, you would have better quality or better inputs that could be supplied to the students. For the state universities and the affiliated colleges, these are considered the backbone of higher education in India. It's only because of this state universities that many of the students can attain higher education, because the rates are at par, and the idea is to enhance these state universities in collaboration with the private investment that is coming up. So those were some of the recommendations. He also talked about that the private commercial providers should be supported, and the growth would be beneficial because it would help to understand the promoter as well as the university or the research institute. And if there is a good link between the promoter and a research university, the private universities could develop very fast. The next is the very good idea of mushrooming of deemed universities. So as we have seen, there has been a sudden spurt in the deemed universities in India. Now, deemed universities in India are a major area of concern that he considers to be. Some of the private institutions also get the recognition for deemed universities. And as per UGC, now it's no longer important for these universities to use the phrase deemed, as they can call themselves simply universities. So that's one of the new recommendations that have come up under the UGC, and it talks about provision for the status of deemed universities that was initially made with a noble intent, but the intent was later on disrupted. So bringing back that into the mainstream is again important. Affordability. Higher education should be very affordable. Charging of exorbitant prices like those in IIMs is really surprising for a common student to understand. And it should bring in competence for the faculty and the students. So providing even competence would be only when you have, you are not charging exorbitant prices. So considering those and the issues of affordability, so for that you should have the fixation of fees norms, and again the quantum of the fees that has to be charged should have a kind of rational basis. The next is bringing in more foreign universities. So if the best foreign universities, we say among the top 200 in the world, we want to come here, then what we need to do is we need to welcome the other foreign universities into India. So what the idea should be, that an institution should give any Indian degree and all the subjects and the rules and regulations would apply to any university in India. So these foreign universities should be allowed to give Indian degrees and they should be considered valid in India, and should these rules should also apply to the Indian university. So those are again some of the important recommendations. Coming on to financing and management, he talked about encouraging or bringing in private investments. Release of funds should be annual so that it could support the implementation of the plans. Bringing in human resource development, he talked about the constraints that have come from the various funding agencies that we talk about. So stopping the role of these recruitment agencies and bringing in a kind of approved format for HRD should be there. Bringing in more autonomy. So far the governance system is very poor in universities. It's highly undermanaged and not at par with the other universities world round. So what we need to bring in is a kind of expertise in educational management. So once you have an expertise in educational management, that could bring in a drastic change in the education system. And again, it's necessary for many state governments to abandon the kind of trend of civil services. Civil servants, those are being appointed as university administrators. So those are some of the recommendations that he talked about, the abandoning the role of civil servants as university administrators. The next is loss of autonomy. Now this loss of autonomy also affects the functioning of universities. So universities should be autonomous, and considering this, recently you have the list of various autonomous universities. Among that you have two important private universities that have been given the status of autonomous universities. One is the PDPU in Gandhinagar, the other is OP Jindal in Sonipat. Now this has been incorporated under the autonomous structure for the universities. So JNU now is autonomous. So all this brings into or reforms the university functioning. So once a university is autonomous, it can bring in more funds, it can bring its, it can become self-sustaining in nature. So those are some of the important points that we need to understand here. Then is subversion from within. So deep introspection by the academic institution should take into place. So once they do a kind of self-analysis of the university or the institutional setup, they would understand the powers and the responsibilities that should be bifurcated or basically spread out. The multiplicity of the regulatory systems. So it talks about the authorities, the duplication, the innovations that should go on. So all these should be established within the society. Now these are the kind of some of the summary of whatever challenges that a higher education system face that we have tried to discuss so far. So we have tried to understand the challenges under distances and disconnect, architects of learning, the structure expansion, the governance and the autonomy, and the various issues of the private universities, the deemed universities, and the foreign universities that should come up. Now, what was the roadmap that he talked about? So he talked about a totally new regulatory framework, which is more holistic in nature. It talks about all higher education systems to be treated as an integrated setup or a kind of unified setup of wholeness. So he talked about the National Commission for Higher Education and Research, which was known as NCHER, and this body would perform the various regulatory functions for the transfer of academic knowledge or imparting academic freedom within the university setup and bringing in more autonomy for the universities. So this body aims to bring in a kind of comprehensive and holistic evaluation system, bring in more autonomy, enhance global connectivity, create links with foreign universities, promote more engagement programs, bring in good governance, and bring in social progress. He also talks about restructuring the universities, as we said. So he focused on the foundational principles on which the restructuring should take place, bringing in more autonomy in the institutions, developing or involving higher education institutions in the various litigation processes that have been taking place, bringing in more research opportunities. The governance system should be strengthened. The poor governance that exists in universities should be removed. And these universities should also employ professionals as fundraisers. So more funds should come in for universities. Once you have more and more funds, you can apply those for research and betterment of the universities. There should be no private motive or private profit motive that a university should be driven with. The system should be very fair, transparent, accountable, and moreover responsible. Some of the important agendas that it talks about is this NCHER body, which is a kind of constitutional body, would replace the existing three bodies, that is the AICTE, that's the technical bodies, and the DEC, the education councils, and therefore it would bring a kind of holistic integration of the various higher education programs. The curriculum would be reformed. The undergraduate programs would be revamped, restructuring of education would take place, more vocational education would be provided. So those are some of the important things that we need to consider under this. Now, what has been the first task of the NCHER is to identify the top 1500 colleges in India and first upgrade those colleges, develop in relationship with the outside world or with the foreign universities, we can say, bring in more capacity building. A kind of national testing scheme should be released. That's again under NTA what we are trying to do, the National Testing Agency. So that's again one of the recommendations under Professor Yashpal committee. And establishing a national education tribunal with the powers. So this tribunal would look on to the various educational formalities and the progress of education. Also establishing a task force for the implementation of various action programs on higher education. Now, what are the basic elements of a new organization of the higher education system? It should be self-sustaining, self-renewing. It should be basically accredited, and it should also be supported. We also need a single higher education commission, which is HEC. So this idea of single higher education commission also comes from Professor Yashpal committee recommendations and is again important. We need to inspect and monitor all the changes that have been taken place, bring in more connectivity and interaction, and a kind of interface between the university and higher education commission. So those are some of the important aspects that have been discussed under Professor Yashpal committee. As we said, Professor Yashpal committee is very, very important for this year. We have tried to bring out a summary of the important developments that have taken place, and some of those have already been applied. For example, the idea of national testing scheme, bringing in autonomous universities. So we already have many universities which are under the list of autonomous universities. Already those are live at the website in the current affairs section, and we also have covered those in the classes on higher education expected questions for 2018. So stay tuned for more classes on higher education. Do subscribe to the channel. If you have any doubts, any questions, leave those as comment below the video. And as we said previously, we also have mock tests that have come up. The links for those are available in the description below the video. Stay tuned. Have a very good day ahead.